I'm gonna speak further about this, the hive. The hive raids, call them the hive because it's a momentia of always here and present. So when it's like this, like the life always, where it is just constant rain, the digital rain feeling. Living in the digital rain air. It's all. You know, why certain thoughts are becoming, you know, here and why the organization also of the certain. Certain aggravate voices that also want to be a ruler, be a controller, and activate me as a puppet of, I guess we call it the digital rain. Is this, we can call it digital rain if that's preferred, but I'm going with this. I don't know, it is a heavy distinction, a heavy distinct air molecule. And I wanted to talk of all of these other things. I know they're so exciting, how the selfish gene, oh my gosh, it got me stuck there because I actually, as a child, lived there on that street. And so it is interesting. And memories there. But I didn't want to access childhood at all. I'm thinking of yeah, oh my gosh, how this digital rain is how the hive is involved with personality. Oh my gosh. Okay, so what does it do? It can bring a person's feminine. We know the metals, the oxides, these salt metals. We know they can bring a person feminine that was a normal male. We know that it can bring them extreme masculine that was normally not so masculine. So we know we can have these changes. So we have all of this going on. And I'm like, well, that is something that you're eating, obviously. That's something the human is eating. And or also it has to be in conjunction with the atomic testings all over the planet that they've had since the 1945. So these atomic testings, again and again and again, there is this nuclear radioactive that is blossomed. So I'm thinking, okay, then there must be there and also the scientist. There has to be the scientist persons who have been working to eat this radioactivity, because that would be something that they would set up scientists to do. You know, find an organism that can eat it, instead of having it can eat us, you know, because it is, in essence, eating us. It's eating us alive. It's eating the metals within us. It's a want for decay, and it's attracted to the others in the metals in us, similar to the car experience, the car that has the salt, they put the salt on the road, and so you have the healthy cell, and it has the salt attached to it, and it becomes the rusted out, it becomes decayed sooner because you've given it so much salt. All right. So you create the electrolyte imbalance, and then what happens? Well, you don't have as much of one particular metal inside that healthy cell, and so the healthy cell is no longer healthy. It's an instable, and so therefore it dies. It dies because it has not been given the correct balance of energy. So we have the decadent salt eater that is a destroyer. Not just the regular mineral salts that is capable. It's just a regular mineral salt. This is nothing that has any hyperactivity attachment of a radioactive element. Nothing of that. But as soon as that is attached also, it does become this metal war, doesn't it? And one just, that's it, you know, here's a happy one, and here goes, just gone, you know. And so that's what it's doing. That's what I'm seeing in the reaction of so I have to think now. Okay, now that these little happy creatures created in chemical laboratories, looking for these nanoproducts, these particular items that were out there to eat at things. Well, my goodness, yes. And once they do find the organism radioactive, that's a wonderful idea, and then they eat at it. But in any experiment, there is always the other, isn't there? You can have the positive, and then there will be the negative of it. There will be the one that is the one that needs the is the opposite, actually, needs the radiation to survive. And so you have that organism that is there going, oh my gosh. So now I have the one that is able to eat the radioactive, and there's the other that is the enemy of, and that particular enemy lives off radioactive and wants to support it. And so it has an agenda. And so, yeah, support those nuclear everythings, and that becomes the enemy. That becomes the enemy, I'll call it a metallium mix. And that particular grouping. So, I don't know where I'm going with this at all, but I really do think they started this in a laboratory. All of this hive alive or whatever. So, back to what was I speaking? Yeah, the rusted of it. So okay, so oh, everybody wants another body, and how live an extra day, or 20, or 30, or maybe even a year. They'll want to know the answer. So okay, so there it goes. I guess it's with the salt. You know, if you get that balance just a little too much on the salt side, there you're already on the depletion of. So. That's an obvious enemy against them. So that becomes. So okay, so I'm looking there. I have perhaps, you know, thinking of rusted metal like this outside. So that's been a metal what attack? Yes, it's been an attack from a salt sky. So, how does the salt sky happen? Well, that would be coming in from, pollutions, they say, but pollutions are carried through with heavy metals. So it is a heavy metal salt that is a degradant. Your initial degradant is a heavy metal salt source. So, yes, because some heavy metals are salt. So you look at it this way. So that is the degradant coming out of the sky to eat also. Eat at the metals of the cars and the fences. All right. So now it is equipped with. I'll try to leave that really interesting laboratory that was in making these radioactive eaters. And wannabe radioactivators, you know, propagators. I'll leave them away from this moment of the discussion, but that we have to think of them, because that is extremely possible in this particular, since 1945, at every university might have been interested in it, even in their science labs, as a work study. How can we eat at it? How can we attack it? You know, that would have been a very simple question from a professor to his students, or professor to, yeah, I often do that. Shame on me, I know. Oh, I know there are the women also in the chemistry there. So what was I saying? So if I know I get so hyper for the one that's already made to go and eat the chevrons, is a hungry force, and it's like that. It's energy, you know. Chevrons. So I have my agenda there is to go and you know, continue the climbing of mountains, and that becomes. Well, my gosh, am I wearing that enough? And you know, inside me already. If that is my thought, you know what I'm saying? It's inside me now. So somehow, either you can't blame this on Monsanto seed. You can't blame it on I just ate an apple. Somehow, it is drifted in and stuck on the brain like for a long time, and it almost becomes a controlant. And so. It is becoming the machine within that has its agenda and has its drive and has its reason. And so it becomes a propellant force to procreate more and more nuclear, because that becomes its harvest beast. That's where it survives through. Energized, you know. Energized at that particular molecular level. It's trying to survive. It's tough to have answer for everything all at once, isn't it? Can you hurry it up? I have a meeting. Can you hurry it up? I have to watch a commercial. So anyway, yeah, the future. Well, 2389, we have the visors on. Now, do I have the visors on? Why? We are wearing the visor specifically. Because our eyes are extremely damaged by the particular light effects created by the excessives. They are excessive mere reflectives that are a currency of the planet. A new economy, yes. A currency of the planet. Nothing such as sweet as a cutesy outlandish as my big mirrors that I was making on my little cartoon Kinder book there on the photo bucket. There's nothing of that science ilk. No, I'm talking little teeny tiny radioactive reflectance that brighten us bigger and bigger every day. So yes, so that is one reason for wearing the visor. The other is we cannot have them access our eyes. We cannot have any of this digital, yes, because at this point it is digital also, digital data, it's holding certain data. Now, because it is holding certain data, it has little miniature chips, yes, I know everybody runs, oh, you can have the little miniature chips in there, it's too small, you can have little miniature chips. But it is essentially, yes, little miniature chips, and they're hungry. For certain minerals, certain elements, certain oxides. And they gain those, yes, even from their own eyesight. So our eyesight is one of the first places that are going to be destroyed. They are a wet area of the body that is extremely exposed. We can look in studies already, we can start thinking of, no, we can't live with salt eyes, can we? You cannot pour salt into your eyes. Can you pour salt in your eyes? And live to see? No, it is not possible to pour salt in your eyes daily, thick extra salt, and see. We cannot live with salted eyes, extra. Oh, I know, I'm quite a drama today. Sorry for the overkill. So what's it doing in there? Extra of the extraordinary. Yes, dissolving. It's dissolving our eyesight. Essentially, it's decaying our eyesight quicker. Just as if it'll become brighter and brighter and brighter, similar to living within Fresnels. Yeah, wonderful. So yeah, that's a main reason also, aside from the brightness, it is so they're not getting wind from their aggressions that would cause the tearing. We can't have any tearing from these moments, because it will be the salted tears, extraordinarily more so. It's similar to tear gassing event. Yes, similar to a tear gassing event. So as life goes, we will have more and more of these. Oh, my eyes, they're stinging. I cannot stop the stinging of my eyes. You know. So we must start being the most removed from emotion. Even there, we have to remove from emotion just to protect our own eyes from sight, from seeing, from being able to see. Yeah, I can't cry, it hurts too much. Just takes like that woe of the I was able before. Have to be harsh. Changes the personality quite abruptly. Whether they want it or not, when it goes straight to the eyes. Oh, we love the future, don't we? Oh, I feel it right now, though. So that's the difference, isn't it? Yeah. Kind of is irrelevant. Dates and numbers. So there they are. They're propagating. Propagating. They love this particular. They love this speakeasy organism. I am their speakeasy, aren't I? I am available to them as an organative moment. I am one who is. Merely harvested, I'm a body harvested with a voice and information that is able to display in a message. Anyway, sometimes I get a little serious. But other times, I don't know, just go with it, you know, go with the flow, right?